Professor Sen. She will be speaking today to us on Towards a Feminist Understanding of Women, State and Patriarchy in the New Millennium.
Thank you very much, Anshu. And I'm very happy to be here with all of you. The discussion, as I say here, it pertains to the period after 1990, most of it. And what I feel at this point is that we can understand the events of the last 20 years as being rooted in two major political fault lines of the political economy. The first is a perceived absence of an adequately nuanced discourse of the whole question of national identity and of the whole concept of Indian nationhood, because that, I mean, many of us sitting here are historians. That is something that, you know, was a creation of a very recent creation. And in a sense, if we look at the whole concept of nation states, the nation states themselves are fairly recent. And what we had in earlier times were empires of, you know, shifting boundaries. And the idea of the Indian nation, and today the political, the ideological reality of the nation state, the whole understanding of the national consciousness, national pride, national interest, understanding of national interest, these are all very recent. And at the same time, they are, you know, they are emphasized over and over in our political and social life. And the absence of nuance in that really makes things very difficult for sections of the population who are not very firmly rooted in that. And so this is one fault line along which protests and mass movements have taken place after 1990. And the second is a contestation between the state and communities on visions of development. Communities, and particularly acquisition of land, acquisition of forest resources, the explorations of mines, the coming of industries, the whole concept of eminent domain, that the state owns whatever does not belong to individuals, the whole concept of community rights, I don't think these are adequately defined, adequately understood in our political discourse. So this is another source of unevenness and of discontent. Normally, we have viewed history in a very homogenized national framework, but there are some works in India and outside on how you can rescue history from the nation, how you can have a different kind of reading on it. And there is a lot of ongoing work on regions, on cultural regions, and on, for example, on particularly in border areas. And for example, in Bengal, there is a lot of writing on the common Bengali identity, the common Bengali heritage, the language Bangla as it is spoken in different parts, and the literature of Bangla across borders. So that is a sort of a kind of a reading of our contemporary politics and history, which does not necessarily focus on the nation. But there are also other examples. I think in India and in China, I mean, these are both countries which have become major superpowers. The idea of centralized vision of the national of the nation state, along with federal and decentralized visions of ideas of people, of communities, of language groups. I mean, our situation is not really like the situation of, you know, where the Kurdish people are divided between three nation states, and they are, you know, trying to make their identity felt, trying to make their existence understood. It's not really as bad as that, but at the same time, there are many groups who do not comfortably fit into this kind of definition. There are several movements along our northeastern borders, as well as in Kashmir, which are challenging this kind of centralized concepts and which draw strength from their own local history, from their local struggles, their identity, their particular definition of their being, of their nationhood. The Manipuri people, the Naga people, the people of Kashmir, but for whatever reason, for reasons of our national security, as the state understands it, the state response has been very strident, and acts like the AFSPA, have the Armed Forces Special Powers Act. These have been in operation for long periods of time. In Manipur, I think it is now over half a century that AFSPA has existed, and an entire generation has grown up in Manipur living under AFSPA, who have never experienced the freedom of an Indian citizen that many of us have enjoyed. And people have not taken this lying down, and people have resisted this. And the political reality, the daily reality of a state like Manipur is full of disappearances, fake encounters, sexual violence against women. The whole episode, which we all remember, which is part of our recent history of Manorama's gang rape and the protest of the Imas, the Manipuri Imas in front of Kangla Fort, the Malom massacre, which led to Sharmila taking up her fast for the repeal of AFSPA. Kashmir has a very convoluted history of accession, and it is located in a very sensitive border region between two neighboring states, India and Pakistan. And the reality of Kashmir is also very, very similar. Women's reality, the reality of half-widows. Half-widows are women who have whose husbands have disappeared, and they do not know, we do not know whether their husbands are alive or dead. So they are half-widows, half-wives. They don't have a normal life. And very often from within the community, from within the larger family, there is a lot of difficulty that they have in dealing with the rest of the families. They have to bring up their effectively single mothers who bring up their children. And at the same time, they cannot form partnerships other than the ones that they have lost, because there is always doubt that the husband is living somewhere and will reappear, but he never does. So, I mean, there have been films made on this, there have been books written, but women have this kind of terrible reality that they're living through in Kashmir. Women have responded. There have been movements of people at various levels, but women's specific responses. In Manipur, we had the Myra Paibis, who with mashals, they lit lamps and lights, and they moved from village to village, alerting the people, A, that the army was on a march, on a flag march, and they were moving, and tried to, A, bring courage to the people of the villages, and secondly, also to alert others that a raid is coming, and please be careful, please, you know, look after yourselves. And also the Manipuri Imas protest before the Kangla Fort, because that was very significant, because Kangla Fort was actually the seat of Manipuri sovereignty, and in a very, very insensitive act that was occupied by Assam Rifles, when the AFSPA was promulgated there, and it became the headquarters of Assam Rifles. And the protest was before Kangla Fort, and we all know what the banners said. Kashmir, there were many organizations that came up, like the Indian People's Tribunal, International People's Tribunal on Kashmir, Jammu Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society, and particularly an organization of women, the Association of Parents of Displaced Persons, in which Parveena Ahangar, who has come to Delhi several times and has spoken, she was very active. And this was an organization of women, basically, who had lost children, who had lost their sons, who had lost their brothers, who had lost their husbands. And these people had disappeared. I mean, many of them were half-widows, many of them were bereaved mothers. And APDP really campaigned to document many of these losses, and campaigned and had sit-ins and tried to keep this issue alive. But there were also other kinds of women's organizations, like the hardline and fundamentalist organization like the Dukhtarane Milat, which Asiya Andrabi, we have seen pictures of her on television and in magazines, robed in black. And she's a member, I mean, her organization is a member of the Hurriyat Conference. And they are much more stridently separatist than many of the other organizations. But I just want to emphasize one thing, that the resistance has been a multicolored and multi-hued resistance. There is no one line, there is no one belief. There are of course, separatist elements in Kashmir, possibly, and in Manipur, of course, in Nagaland, in many of these places. But there are also others who are trying to live a peaceful life and trying to live within the system and trying to somehow make sense of the lives that have been disrupted. Contestations about the development paradigm has led to a conflict of interest in people's resistance at many locations in the last 25 years. As we have liberalized, as we have opened up our economy, as industry and finance capital has come in, has been welcomed for mining, for industry, and particularly the resource-rich states of Central India, of Orissa, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Telangana. And the conflicts have been at many levels. Singur, in the context of land acquisition for the nano factory, despite the fact that Tata has withdrawn the plant, the idea of the plant, the land has still not gone back to the original tillers, the people from whom the land was acquired. And the land around Singur was a very fertile agricultural land, so that was one issue with it. Nandigram, where the land was proposed to be acquired for a chemical hub. POSCO in Odisha, in Jagatsingpur. And there are these villages of Dinkia, Patana, Govindpur, Nuagaon, etc., where land was proposed to be acquired, and there was a very militant resistance to that. Niamgiri, where bauxite mining was proposed for the Vedanta plant. So these institutions had already come up, and so it was obviously a very planned kind of a project that was prepared, that went through. I mean, what is interesting here is that the projects were prepared, proposed, they went through various departments and files in government ministries, and obviously it was all well charted out before the people on the ground got to know that their land was proposed to be acquired for this or for that. And Jaitapur, of course, where Areva reactors, French reactors, were going to be used, are being used to propose for the new nuclear plant. Now, there are issues at several levels. One is, of course, the entire issue of land acquisition, whether land acquisition is warranted, and what happens to the communities that are going to be displaced. The whole issue of livelihoods, because it is not also just a question of land. And very often, the official definition of project affected persons is problematic, because only people whose lands are being taken are classified officially as PAP, and who are entitled to some kind of compensation. But there are other people who are, for example, sharecroppers. In Singur, this was a major problem. The sharecroppers, people who are landless laborers, people who work in the forest, there are people who fish, many other kinds of people whose livelihoods are also affected because of these companies coming and who are simply not recognized. Employment, if it is offered to one person in a family. And that really does not take care of the livelihood of an entire, very often, Adivasi community, where everybody works, and where women particularly work in forest collections, women work in horticulture, they work on agriculture. So what happens to the livelihood of the others? So this whole concept of the individual worker and the family wage that is inherent in this of offering employment to one person, this becomes a problem for the communities that are affected. In all of these struggles, women have been very active participants. And in 2013, there was this article by Pramodini Pradhan and Ranjana Padhi. I'll just read a little bit out of that about the struggles in Orissa. Many of these resistance movements are notable for both a significant presence of women as well as for the harshness of the repression they face at the hands of the state agencies responsible for law enforcement, as well as industry personnel. For the communities and for the women, it is often a desperate resistance because of the heightened nature of the stakes. When we look at the class and caste character of these women, we find that they are mostly from the peasantry, Dalit, tribal, or fisher folk communities. Even the landless women have been visible in these struggles. It needs to be noted that in all these communities, women have a direct link to the productive process, whether it is agriculture, fishing, collection of forest produce, or even as wage laborers. In a patriarchal society, these women hardly own land or other productive resources. They hardly count in taking decisions in the management of community-owned common resources, but they surely are active participants in the economic activities in various ways. Hence their stake in the protection of their land, water, and forests, which are crucial for their survival. Different states deploy security forces, the state police, the paramilitary forces, the India Reserve battalions, which are brought in to crush the resistance. There is also a kind of a vocabulary of anti-state disturbing elements, who are trying to disrupt the national interest and trying to disrupt development, complete identification of finance capital and state apparatus, sexual violence and militarization over large parts of central India once this conflict gets going. And this is a common story, a very tragic story in many parts of central India, including the area that I come from. Now, all of this has to be seen together with changes in labor law practice, with privatization, dependence on contract labor, and all of this put together has brought into question in many of these areas and in many of these communities the commitment of the state to social justice, which again has led to questioning the relationship of the women's movement with the state, and also the faith that sections of the women's movement earlier had with legal reform and with state-based action. I mean, many of us who are oldies in the movement, like we date from the 70s, there were important campaigns that we have all been part of earlier for reforms in rape law, even more recently, after the Verma Commission, at the time of after the Nirbhaya rape, and the fact that many of us testified before the Verma Commission. But at the same time, there is a certain loss of faith in what the state can do for us. Some of the concerns, yet this is a very kind of a complex juncture at which we are. Some of the concerns and issues for the women's movement at this juncture I want to point out. One is the breakdown to a large extent of the connection between the visible and the recognized women's organizations, the autonomous women's movement, and the grassroots struggles with large women's participation that is taking place. Because, I mean, this question has always existed. I mean, what is the women's movement and, women's movement and women in movements? Is it the same? When women participate in movements in large numbers, does that make it a women's movement? Or, kind of a more refined question is, what is a feminist movement? What kind of questions do you have for a movement to qualify as a women's movement, etc.? But today we see that the women's movement defined in a certain way, and which is visible, which is identified as such, and grassroots women's movement, where large numbers of women are participating on livelihood issues, on issues of survival, they are not able to reach out, and they're not speaking to each other anymore. I have started my report with a study of the Patna Conference in 1988. In 1988, I mean, there were some absences, but there were major women's groups and major mass struggles going on in Bihar, which came together to discuss women's issues in mass struggles. And that is how where my own interest in women in mass movements was born. There were subsequent women's conferences which were similar, but which had, it was a problematic trajectory. There was Calicut in 1991, there was Tirupati in 1994, and the last one was Ranchi in 1997. The NGO dominance of sections of the autonomous women's movement and the disconnect with grassroots struggles is responsible also to a large extent. The whole issue of resources and how do you fund conferences like that. The autonomous women's movement's concerns also with issues of sexuality and identity to the exclusion of mass struggles, that isolates it. So there are all these issues for which reason we are, we have this kind of situation today. While we validate women's large participation in mass struggles, I think it is important to avoid a certain kind of homogenization of women's experience, because women also come to mass movements with different kinds of issues, different kinds of understanding. Women's understanding of development, often there are different articulations and interests of women, even if they're in the same struggle. I just want to show you two pictures from Jaitapur. One is of women who are marketing fish, who are from the Karavi community in Sakrinate, and who are mainly concerned about the loss of fishing and the loss of, I mean, even in fishing, the women are not themselves going to sea. It's the men who go to sea, the men who fish, but the marketing is done by women, and the women also weave the nets. So they have a particular stake in the fishing industry. But the issue now is that because of the plant activity, the temperature in the ocean will rise. And there is the other kind of movement that is going on. And there are other women who are on the streets who are opposing nuclear energy. Sarvani Garza Naku Anu Urja, that is one of the major slogans of the Jaitapur movement. So they are opposing nuclear energy itself and the model of development that is energy intensive, that needs a particular kind of continuous and increased energy supply to keep civilization going. So these are two different streams. They're both in the Jaitapur struggle, but it's important to understand that they both have different voices. And of course, there are women like Vaishali Patil, who are the ideologues and organizers, who are, I mean, many of us may have heard her, who speak about the entire issue of Jaitapur. There are debates on understanding experience. How do you understand experience? How do you interpret experience? On women's agency, do women have agency in the movements? Do they not? Are they dominated by the male leadership? I mean, these are questions which have been going on, I think, for almost as long as any of us have been talking about women in movements, and those questions still remain. Subjectivity, women's connect with their communities and with their societies that they come from. How are women's experience mediated? I want to say that there are no easy answers. Who represents women's movements, the construction of women's role in movements? For example, Manipuri women's role is very visible, is important. In all of the literature on Manipur, when we are talking of women, it's anybody who's writing on Manipur, the fact that, Manipuri, I mean, always there is inevitably almost a paragraph that reads something like, Manipuri women were in the forefront of the struggle against the British in 1904 and in 1939, and they are also there today, which is of course true. But the movement for Manipur, for freedom in Manipur, that is every Manipuri's movement. It's not just that the women, it's not as if the women are leading it. The women are very visible, but what exactly is the nature of that participation, how the Manipuri women, so that needs a much deeper study of the position of Manipuri women in Manipuri community. Also, understanding of patriarchy in Meitei society, because Meitei society is Hinduized society and there is patriarchy in Meitei society. So one cannot say that, it cannot be a simplistic statement either way. POSCO struggle in Dhinkia, in Jagat Singhpur, there were many instances when women, and I believe this was also the case in Kudamkulam, when women and children were lying down in the village and they were barricading the village with their bodies. Now, what does this mean and what does this represent? Is it really a spontaneous action of women? Is it a kind of a conjointed decision of the entire movement that women are positioned in the front lines like this? Is it for publicity? Is it for protection? Is it for, I mean, there can be as many understanding, as many interpretations, I think, as there are voices. So the whole issue of representation, of publicity, of publicizing the movement, because after all, if you are struggling, you need to get your voices across to others and to gain their support, of consensus building, of ownership. There are also slightly problematic issues of adoption of assumed identities and dress codes as a protest symbol. For example, Kashmiri women who are in extremist, fundamentalist Islamic organizations who are dressing up in burqas and trying to present an Islamic face to the world. And this really was not part of Kashmir's culture because women in Kashmir did not traditionally wear the burqa. At the same time, there are sections of women for whom it is important as an identity assertion to do that today. What does this mean? I mean, in a sense, it is a... women's movement from the beginning, it has been an assertion for space, for freedom, for openness, for coming together. And in a sense, this is a negation of that, the fact that you have to cover yourself behind a parda to assert an identity and in order to launch your protest. So it's a complex reality, and how do we interpret that? Again, there are no easy answers. The interconnections of mass struggles and women's struggles today raise many questions, probably more more questions than we have answers. One thing is clear, that the patriarchal structures of the state stands exposed today. Struggling women on the ground have never been closer to the basic issues of life and livelihood than at this moment in history. But solidarity and sisterhood across classes probably is at its lowest ebb.